Welcome back. I'm Mike Prokopeak, Editor-in-Chief for Workforce Magazine. It's a pleasure to have you join us for our live stream from day two of the Unleash Conference. Just a couple of quick reminders. We're going to be doing a number of interviews today. They will be recorded so that you can always come back later and check these out as well. So be sure to share the message with your friends. Come back and check out all of our conversations that we're having here at the Unleash Conference over time. I'm really excited about this next conversation and to welcome our next guest, because I think we've been talking quite a bit over the last day or so about technology reshaping work, automation, many of the sort of outside trends that are reshaping work.
Yeah.
But we haven't talked about how the role of the CHRO, the Chief Human Resource Officer, is changing. So I'm really pleased to welcome Kelly Hartman, who is the Chief People Officer for Flywire, to talk a little bit about how the Chief Human Resource Officer role is changing. So welcome, Kelly.
Thank you. Thanks for having me here.
Yeah. So that's tell me a little bit about Flywire. So in case there folks don't know about, what is Flywire?
So Flywire, in essence, is a receivables payment platform serving a number of verticals. So we have predominantly our revenue comes from our education market. Mm-hmm. So it's a B2B business. So universities like Harvard, Yale, MIT, students that international students, whether you're from China, Australia, Nigeria, and you want to go study in America, sometimes the fees are very expensive, right? Mm-hmm. So when they do cross-border payments, so they use our platform to pay. So so we have that, and we have our hospitals, so our healthcare vertical, and we also have commercial, which is predominantly travel, so Expedia and hotels combined.
How big is the company?
There are 400 people at the moment.
Okay.
So we call them Flymates. So our colleagues are called Flymates. So we have 400 Flymates across about 10 different locations. So it's spread right across the world.
In a relatively new company.
About 8 years. So yeah.
Okay. And you've been there how long now?
1 year and about 6 months. So quite new myself.
Yeah. Well, so this is a good time to talk about the evolution of the CHRO role. Was that role there before you came in as Chief People Officer?
No.
Okay.
So we had two directors, and I think as we scaled and grew, the board and the executive realized that they needed someone to help partner with them to help scale the business and drive and facilitate and enable the growth of the business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's kind of a common startup story. People they focus on building a business, identifying a market, building a product, and then after the fact they sort of think about, we actually have to professionalize how we run things. And that's a lot of times where the HR role comes in, which do you think that's too late in the process, or do you think it's, does it depend?
Yeah, I think they need a HR person to start with the business, because your key asset in any company is its people, and they did have directors. I think that they, those directors were really great from when we started with the processes and things like that, which is probably not my forte. So I'm not really good at the early stage putting all processes, policies together, but then they needed someone to get us to the next stage of growth. And I think that's always an evolution in any startup, that you're constantly looking at your workforce and people that were there, to start the business, to get it to the first, 200 people and growth at a certain kind, may not necessarily be the best people to take it to the next level.
Yeah, so they need to bring in somebody who can think strategy and really has the experience in many cases. So maybe let's take a step back, because I want to talk about the evolution of the role, and you sort of have a green field, or had a green field for the role at Flywire.
Yeah.
But what do you see as the outside factors that are reshaping the CHRO role? That's kind of hard to say.
Yeah.
Chief Human Resource Officer.
Chief Human Resource. We call them Chief People Officers.
Chief People Officers, So what do you see as, that's actually what you're going to be speaking on a little bit later on today at the conference. What do you see as the outside factors that are changing that job?
Okay, so my personal philosophy, and I think, I've spoken about this many times, I wasn't in HR for many years, and the reason I was in HR, I didn't like HR. So I played a HR quasi-cottage industry role, but for a CIO, or I worked at Deutsche Bank for many years, but I worked in technology under the technology arm. And what I was doing was a HR role, but not under the arm of the HR world.
You were within a functional line of business.
Yeah, so. And that happened to me right through my career. Someone would pick me up and we want her, because for a HR person, I think I've said this many times, there's not a business strategy and a HR strategy. You are part of the business. It is one strategy. And for an evolving, CPO, or what we expect from HR, you need to understand the business. You need to be commercial. You need to be agile. You need to be quick. You need to have empathy, leadership. It's not a control role. So I'm much more business focused. I take a lot of risks. So I think that is more of the role. I know that there's a lot of technology and things coming in that helps our job more effective, it's easier, more efficient, but we're still, you know, using that data to make decisions. You still need the empathy and the leadership and things like that. So it's a balance, it's not taking over.
Yeah. I mean, I remember talking to a chief human resource officer a few years ago, and, you know, talking about how do you spend your day-to-day?
Yeah.
And most of it was spent on regulations, making sure the company didn't get sued. It was not very exciting work.
No.
It's, in fact, very compliance-focused. It's, you know, they don't do the fun stuff. But as you're saying, that really has to change as the speed of business changes,
sure,
as technology becomes just ingrained in how we do work, and it has been ingrained in how we do work. Let's not say it's becoming; it is.
Yeah.
You know, so how do you spend your day to day then? I mean, what do you? What sort of things do you do that might perhaps be a little bit different than they were 10 years ago?
Sure. So some of it is hunting, like recruitment. Mm-hmm. My CEO, he's amazing. He found me on LinkedIn, and I wasn't looking for a job at the time. So I love the fact that we do a lot of our own recruitment and hunting. So part of it is that. A lot of it is coaching. Some of it's org design. Some of it's, you know, changing the structure, strategy, spending time with our people. Of course, leadership, coaching. Sometimes I, you know, facilitate training, people days to discuss our people. So a lot of, you know, my role is spent, you know, focusing on the talent and the coaching and things like that. Of course, there's compliance stuff. I need to make sure, you know, that we're compliant, that
it's important.
Know,
I don't mean to minimize it.
Yeah, the processes, mobility. You know, as the changing workforce, a lot of the workforce is remote, right? So, you know, we're setting up new entities in Latin America and in Korea and things like that. So part of the job is, okay, working out what the design looks like. You know, do we, you know, set up an entity out there? Do we put them on contract? Is it a PO structure? So a lot of it is, how do we facilitate the growth of our business a lot of the time?
Yeah. Going back to that point you were just making sort of about not really liking HR early in your career, and maybe you just still don't, and that, you know, healthy skepticism is a good thing about the work that we do. But, you know, as you look at how HR people are developed, you were fortunate in the sense that you were embedded into a line of business. You didn't have that separation between what the people side of work and what was getting done on the front lines.
Yeah.
That was just part of what you did. As you look at how other HR people are being developed, what do you see as the gaps that they need to fill in their own career development in order to have that sort of experience that will lead them into roles like yours that are, you know, more future focused, more growth focused, not so backward looking, not so protection minded?
Yeah. I think for HR people, like in the future, I think they need to spend time in the business, like having a business role. Like, I think many of my roles, as I said, were spent time in the business. So you were commercial, you're sitting on the leadership team. So I think they need time outside of HR to do something. Yeah. I also was seconded to a charity helping young people live their dreams for 3 years, paid by a bank. And so then I had a whole different spectrum in sales and working with top executives from all over the world and setting up NGOs. So I think sometimes life experience, and I really mean that from every perspective, because you've got to understand the business, you've got to understand the world.
Yeah.
Part of my role sometimes is selling. You know, I get, you know, recruitment agencies, leadership people coming into me, and then I'll turn it around and bring my salespeople in from the commercial segment, and we'll make a sale together. And,
yeah,
and that's happened a number of times. So I think spending time in the business or spending time in a different role.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that relationship side of it, I think people think of chief people officers, chief human resource officers. You get in this because you like people.
Yeah.
You like working with people, you like helping them, you like solving problems. But then at the same time, they sort of neglect the relationships outside of that sort of traditional HR point of view. So as you mentioned, you know, having those relationships with salespeople so that you're not just, you know, the person who comes in when there's a problem, you're actually on the front line kind of helping them solve problems. You're building business with them.
Yeah.
And I think that skill set for HR people, building relationships with people in business lines, sort of gets neglected.
For sure.
Sometimes. I mean, would you agree with that?
Yeah, and going out with the clients. Like, I go out with my clients,
yeah,
with our relationship managers, so understanding what the business does. You know, all the executive recently sat down with our customer service reps, and they do an unbelievable job in what they do. And you sit down and listen to their calls and how they multitask every day. And, you know, I think everyone should go through that. So, you know, I think you made a good point before. You know, you would think that most HR people like people.
Yeah.
And I think in my life, I found a lot of HR people that didn't like people. So people used to say to me, Kelly, I can't believe you're in HR, you actually care for people. And that I used to laugh at that, because there's so many people that I came across in my career in HR they didn't care for people. They wanted to work with the executives. Yeah. And I think probably, you know, a lot of my time is spent on the floor with people, like, yeah. you know, with every single level of the organization. And sometimes you meet HR people, and we see it in interviews too. We bring them in and, you know, we want them to mix with our fly mates, and they just want to know where the CEO is or the executive. Mm. And then we never give them a job, because it's about building relationships with everyone.
Yeah. So let's stay on that point, actually.
Yeah.
So that point about the human part of the work.
Sure.
Because I think as technology comes in and you know, automates a lot of our processes
of
that were done in person, there is a danger that we can sort of lose sight of that side of the work that we do. So where do you sit, and how do you bring in the human piece of it? Because it's a technology company.
Yeah, I mean, it's a technology company.
Yeah, I mean, so how do you maintain the human? What are some things that you do to ensure that those relationships are built, that people feel that they're just not a part of a machine, a technology machine that's doing it? So how do you retain the human element?
So we have a lot of social events, we have well-being events, we have roundtables with the executives, we have roundtables with other leaders, we have all company meetings, we've had all company retreats before. So, you know, 2 years ago we all went to Morocco, the year before that St. Thomas. So there's a lot. We're not seeing travel as a cost.
Yeah.
You know, we're seeing travel as an investment.
As a connection.
Yeah. And when we have one-on-ones and we connect, we use, you know, our videos, our, you know, our Google Hangouts, our WhatsApp, and we're constantly, you know, we've got a lot of Slack channels, obviously, but we share stuff like travel stories or water coolers and parents or, you know, we could have activities like pets and things like that. So there's always this, it's an amazing human element at Flywire.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what I love about it. So we will never lose that. And it comes, you know, I think the difference is, and I've said this many times before, usually, you know, HR would be driving the people, you know, the people element of it and pushing stuff, but it comes down from our CEO. And that is the beauty, and that's why I love working for Flywire. Mike Massaro is an amazing CEO that, you know, he'll go downstairs and he'll go to a different city or he'll be in Boston and he's like, okay, whoever, the first 10 people for coffee in 10 minutes, we're going out. And we just do stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, when I travel a lot, and I travel a lot for my role, it's not like I just mix with the senior people, you know, going out for dinner. I'll just take a cross-section of people. Like, we constantly, people get to experience, you know, the same type of restaurants and things that everyone does in the company.
So do you have advice? So you're fortunate in that position that you do have a CEO and a leadership that, you know, is engaged with people and sees the importance of it. Not everybody's in that fortunate position. If somebody is in that position where their leadership may be disengaged from the front line or from people who are doing work, not from any sort of malintent, they're just, you know, they're obviously focused on work, or they came from a very technical background, and that's the piece of it that they do.
Or they just don't have that. I've worked with CEOs like that. They just don't know. They don't know any different. So it takes a lot of coaching and showing them the impact that their experience has. And that takes a lot of time and effort, but I've been in many roles like that too. So I think it's really important that not everyone has my luxury. I'm glad, because it was really important for my next role to have and partner with a CEO that does that. But I think if someone doesn't do that, then you need to find people in the leadership team and executive team that are champions of it, because I'm sure there's one, and use them as well.
Yeah, it's almost like a camouflage way of doing
of
it.
Course.
Like, you got to find those people who you see the potential in being able to do it, and just ally yourselves with them and support the things that they do, because if they're spreading the message of the work that the chief people officer is trying to do, that makes your job so much easier.
Yeah, and I think it's important, like, sometimes I put, you know, in diary, like, notes, like, hey, this person started today, or this person just had a baby, or this person got promoted, or they've got a big presentation, don't forget to write them a note. So, and then they'd come, Kelly, I'm doing it by myself, no. So it's that type of thing that you may need to handhold them just for a bit.
Yeah, all right, so last question, we're just about out of time here.
Okay.
As you look at the future of the chief people officer role, what are the couple of things that you think people really need to think very deeply about if they're going to be successful in that role?
Yeah.
What are those sort of things that, if they intend to be successful, if they intend that their company is going to be successful with them in that role, the things that they really need to think very deeply about right now?
Yeah, I think totally is really understanding the business. It's number one, and understanding the people and what they do. Like, how can you bring in talent? How can you look at location strategy? How can you work in the business if you don't understand what the people in the business do?
Mm-hmm.
So you've got to understand our clients, our business, what people do. That's number one. And two is, you've got to be strong and challenged. Like, you know, I'm not the most popular person all the time, because I'm going to call out stuff, you know? My and that's really important. You know, I think I used to just want to be loved and liked all the time. I realize in my role that isn't going to happen, and there's going to, you know, I'm going to polarize some people, but it's important to stay your ground and be honest with the execs and be honest, you know, with you're the partner to the business, so don't be afraid to, you know, have those and call it out sometimes too. And then empathy and understanding for, you know, for the people in your organization is critical.
Be
kind to everyone and know that you're not there to control and say no to everything. Like, how do you enable the business rather than a control, you know? And I think that's what, you know, we talked about all the compliance and the risk, which is important, but you've got to also take risks and say, you know what, you know, you've got to understand the implications of that too.
Yeah. Well, Kelly, thank you so much for talking. This has been fun. I appreciate you coming and sharing your perspective.
Yeah, I've had fun too.
It sounds like you're a busy person, and appreciate you taking just this short time to talk about this kind of thing.
Thank you.